forum organizers for inviting me to do this lecture. I will read it because my English is not very fluent, but hopefully it will be understandable. The Balearic Islands were the target of military expeditions before formal occupation in 902. An expedition was undertaken in the year 707 to the islands of Mallorca and Menorca by the fleet of Ifriqiya. This was the first one. At the end of the 8th century, we know that other expeditions were undertaken, and in the year 848, a naval expedition to Mallorca and Menorca was organized by the Emir Abdelrahman, because the islanders had broken a pact, a previous pact. The chronicler Ibn Hayyan mentions the breaking of a previous pact, indeed, which had probably been established during the expedition of the 707. This pact granted peace to the inhabitants of the Husun, which is the Arab term for fortifications, in exchange for the payment of a very hard tribute comprising one third of their wealth and people. There is no mention of Ibiza in any of the chronicles which describe these expeditions. In fact, there is no archaeological evidence that can be securely dated between the 8th and the 10th centuries in Ibiza. It is possible that there was a significant population decline during this period, to the point that the Andalusian chroniclers show no need to include Ibiza as part of the pacts. Some authors are still recently underlying the fact that there is a very scant archaeological evidence from the 8th and 9th centuries, and that is a common feature of the three islands. Mas Florid, Cau, and Ferrea Barzuza are the latest authors pointing at this evidence. Very few finds have been recorded, and it is not yet possible to describe the settlement pattern between the early 8th century and the end of the 9th century. Findings of coins of the 8th and 9th century could be explained, according to Barceló and Retamero, by the existence of fiscal relationship as a result of the mentioned pacts. After the events in the mid-9th century, the islands were not mentioned again by Arab sources until the official conquest done by Hisham al-Hawlani, a Yemeni, in 902. Although these sources only mention the island of Majorca, the immigration of tribal groups from the eastern part of Al-Andalus took place on the three islands. Since Ibiza was geographically the closest to the Iberian Peninsula, it must have also functioned as a stopover point for those traveling to Majorca and Menorca. A number of governors, wali, named by the Emir of Cordoba, came after the first governor, Hisham al-Hawlani. The presence of an amil, a delegate whose main function was to collect the taxes of a district, on behalf of the emir and future caliph Abdelrahman, shows that the islands were submitted to the Umayyad authority. A number of individuals with this role have been documented throughout the 10th century. However, Retamero and Moll have emphasized the weak presence of the Caliphate authority as evidenced in the numismatic record. Again, according to Retamero, the colonization of the islands after the 902 was undertaken separately from the administrative organization of the Caliphate, as the Caliphate was not able to control the creation of new settlements from a fiscal point of view. Following the numismatic record, then, it seems that migration has neither administratively directed nor organized. Only in the 11th century was the Taifa state capable of regular fiscal intervention in the rural networks of settlements. In this context, we should also note the insignificance of the development of Medina Mallorca, the main city of the islands, before the 11th century. Thus, it can be suggested that the establishment and function of administrative districts in Mallorca, or of the so-called terrae of, in Latin documents, in Ibiza, occurred after an organized rural colonization. We know of these administrative divisions through Catalan documents written after the Christian conquest of the Balearic Islands in the 13th century. The repartiment, the remembranza in Mallorca, and the memoriale divisionis in Ibiza. All are written records of the distribution of the newly conquered lands between the feudal lords who participated in the conquest. Written references to the administrative organization of the islands are so scarce that it's difficult to trace how it worked or how or who held the main responsibilities. But the tribal groups established in the islands don't seem to have been excluded, since they were enough influent to give their name to the administrative districts. Barceló has analyzed the toponymy associated with these administrative divisions, and some of which are related to well-identified Berber groups. Artà, nowadays Artà, coming from Yartan, which is the Arabization for the name of the Berber Aitiraten, Canarrosa from Canarrosa, which derives from the word Canat, and that should be related to the Banu Arús, Manacor refers to the Berber Mancur. Concerning Menorca, no evidence for similar administrative divisions exists. The document generated by the 1287 conquest divide Menorca into three major portions or termini: Ciutadella, the castle of Santa Àgueda, and the castle of Mao. It is unclear whether these termini were based on Muslim administrative divisions. The three castles, named Husum in the Arabic sources, which we know of in Mallorca, were already occupied before 902, and were used by the inhabitants of Mallorca as a shelter from which they could resist attack, as mentioned in several Arab chronicles, in their accounts of the pre-conquest expeditions and the conquest of Hisham al-Hawlani. Al-Zuhri describes the Hisham al-Harun as a large fortress where the Rum, local inhabitants, hide and resisted over 8 years. Ibn Khaldun mentions how Hisham al-Hawlani undertook the conquest by means of occupying one by one all the Husum. Furthermore, the three Husum of Alaró, Felanitx, and Pollença are mentioned by Al-Idrisi in the 12th century. And finally, all of them reappear in the narrations and documents of the Catalan conquest in the 13th century. A thorough study of this Husum has not yet been undertaken. All of these Husum are located on a big rock platforms where there are several cisterns and walls, especially where it is easier to climb. In Alaró and Felanitx, springs of fresh water once existed, though are now lost. Many documents of the 13th and 14th centuries refer to works completed in the castles, but it's difficult to ascertain, without a careful analysis and excavation, the building phases and their chronologies. The recent despoilment of the castle of Sanctuary discovered significant remains of Byzantine and Muslim date, especially coins, rings, bulls, weightings, and buckles. Other small fortifications could exist at least where place names indicate their existence. Castuloxam, Castelo, Castel, El Castellam, Castellich, Castellullon, all names that are recorded in written documents. The last one, Castulleon, should be in Arabic Castil al-Yun, the castle of the springs, and was probably located in the Puig de Randa in the center of the island, where several dry stones have been identified but not properly studied. The fact that these fortifications have been preserved in the place name of some rural settlements, alquerías, it's the Arabic name, demonstrates that they were probably peasant structures. In any case, in the 13th century, they were viewed in the post-conquest written records as rural settlements, as alquerías. Only a small fortified site has been recently excavated in the northwest of the islands by Albero, Garcia and others. The Puig de Namorisca in Calvià is a talayot, prehistoric megalithic tower, against which three rooms were built during the medieval period. The excavation of the rooms has yielded a number of earths and pottery assemblages. The site has been identified as a hill where, according to James, the King James Chronicle, the Andalusian defenders took a stand against the Catalan invaders in 1229. Most of the pottery found in the excavation has been dated to this period, although some pieces suggest that the site might have been inhabited from as early as the 11th century. In any case, the medieval rooms are in all respects identical to other domestic structures found elsewhere on the islands, like those excavated in Menorca by Jerez Juez or myself. In Menorca, the Catalan records concerning the Pact of Capdepera, signed by King James and the inhabitants of the island, and also concerning the conquest of the island, clearly distinguish between the castles Mahó, Santa Àgueda, and Ciutadella. Three castles then. Ciutadella is the translation of Alcasso, an urban fortification, which in the Pact of Capdepera is alluded to as Almudaina de Porto Minoricarum, the fortified palace of the port. In a brief description of Menorca from mid 13th century, Ibn Said al-Maghribi claimed that the center of the island was dominated by a big fortress, a chism, probably referring to the castle of Santa Àgueda. The toponym Centagains, mentioned in the Pact of Capdepera, has been interpreted by Rosilio Bordoy as one of those cases in which sen or san is derivated of sanat, slope or hillside, and agais in this case comes from agais, the plural of ajus, old. Catalan notaries transformed it in a saint place name. The castle of Santa Àgueda is at the summit of the third highest hill on the island. The fortification is rather large, approximately 5 hectares in size, and can be divided into three enclosures with towers. Different construction phases can be appreciated, but their chronology is uncertain because the castle has not been subject to archaeological excavation. A recent intervention carried out by the Consell de Menorca, the local government institution, in order to clean and consolidate a wall, a system, and the chapel, has not revealed new details about the chism. Also, a road was built to allow access for the equipment necessary for the works, causing damage to two sections of the wall. These works were undertaken with no expert archaeological supervision. Water supply depended on cisterns, some of which are very large. The remains of the walls can be appreciated in the interior of the castle, and there are large quantities of tiles and pottery that suggest permanent occupation. There are no fortification remains in Ibiza apart from the city walls, but there is mention in the Memoriale Divisionis of two quila located on the boundaries of the districts. At present, there is no archaeological evidence for this. Quila, in singular, is one of the terms used in the Arab literature sources to designate the earliest fortifications after the conquest in Al-Andalus. So, one of them, Jebel al-Kalaf, lent his name to a hamlet, Karya al-Kalaf, which indicates the loss of its original defensive role. The function and location of the fortifications are uncertain. The toponym Sakala in Formentera is located on the top of a coastal cliff on the northeastern part of the island. The site has been recently excavated by Ramon and Colomar with the goal of investigating a prehistoric fortification. The toponym does not refer to a cove or a small beach. In Catalan, cala means small beach. There are not coves in this part of the coast. The fact that the site comprises a prehistoric wall and tower, to which several rooms, medieval rooms, were added during the Islamic period, similarly to the Namorisca site already mentioned, suggests that the toponym is Islamic, stemming from Al-Kala, and that it refers to a small fortification which reused prehistoric structures. As in the case of Namorisca in Mallorca, the rooms included remains of earths built with refractory clay and pottery assemblages that in this case were heavily distorted. Again, this kind of structures are also found in 13th century excavation of domestic context in Menorca. A new pattern of settlement was organized after the conquest. The great majority of clans or tribal groups which immigrated to the islands came from Al-Andalus, the Iberian Peninsula, and they established themselves shortly after the conquest of the islands by Isam al-Hawlani in 902. According to Barceló, the possibility of colonizing the islands was not considered until the activities of the Bahriyun, groups of sailors with tribal organization, provided the necessary information on harbors, routes, naval requirements, and settlement conditions. This pre-conquest assessment was essential for the effective organization of the migrant groups. So the bulk of the migration would have taken place from the 902 onwards. The strong homogeneity in the settlement patterns and the technology that was employed to transform the rural landscape indicates that the colonization was completed in a brief period of time. The skills and knowledge required to do the selection of places where to build agricultural spaces and settlements would have been acquired in mainland Al-Andalus before the conquest at the beginning of the 10th century. So the process of colonization can be recognized in the spatial decisions made by the groups of migrants. Irrigated areas appear to be the axis around which all other technical choices were made. The term for these rural settlements, used in the documentary sources from Al-Andalus and in the bulk of Catalan documents, is alqueria, in Arab caria. Guichard defines the Alqueria as a rural hamlet or village inhabited by a human group with a common origin, whether tribal or clan. This has led some researchers to identify the term with a place of rural residence. However, the Alqueria is more than this. It also refers to a territory where there can be more than one residential area, more than one cultivation area, including pastures and gathering areas. The boundaries of these lands are not always precise, and we do not know how permeable they were. There are cases where within the boundaries of a clan territory there were many other clan settlements. We will see some examples later. The records written after the conquest of Mallorca often provide detailed descriptions of even the smallest alquerías, down to the number of houses from 3 to 20 houses, the biggest one. A document, for instance, a document from 1281 describes 3 hamlets in the valley of Alaró. Benaugir was made up of 8 houses, a vegetable garden, 2 vineyards, and 2 olive tree groves. Yarfan had 4 houses, 2 plots of cereals, and 2 gardens, comprising an irrigated area of less than 1 hectare in size. Banyuls had 3 houses, a mosque, 2 plots cultivated with fodder, 3 vegetable gardens, a vineyard, and a plot of land which the document describes as uncultivated, comprising an irrigated area of 3.5 hectares in size. So, very small size settlements. Other alquerías are somewhat bigger and are generally found in association with larger irrigation systems. Buñola, for example, must have had a maximum of 20 houses and 10 irrigated hectares, while Alaró had approximately 10 houses and 15 irrigated hectares. It is more difficult to establish with any precision the function of the raals, in Arab rahal. The definition provided by Guichard refers to a private exploitation, usually located on the outskirts of the towns. However, this description would only fit the rahals located in the immediate surroundings of Medina Mallorca, where there are a number of them, some of which belonged to people with a public role. In the rural areas, by contrast, the rahals seem to have constituted peasant workplaces that played a complementary role to the alquerías. Rahals were areas of pasture, cultivated plots, farms. Some had groups of houses similar to those found in alquerías. In the documents produced after the Catalan conquest, which record the size of alquerías and rahals, the latter are said to be comparatively smaller. There are a number of documentary examples where alquerías are mentioned with their rahal or rahals. This association between the alqueria and the rahals reinforces the interpretation of rahals as complementary areas of work linked to the alquerías. Some of the rahals evolved to a more stable settlement similar to the alquerías. Some of them are called alquerías in the Christian written record. For instance, the rahal Kawas was called alqueria rahal Kawas, showing that Catalan conquerors didn't see a significant difference between a rahal and an alqueria. Probably what originally was only a subsidiary working area had become a distinct and stable settlement by the 13th century. Alquerías and reals were organized in networks of settlements established around irrigated areas and in large clan territories were meadows, woodland, and scrubland allowed for livestock farming, hunting, and gathering. Irrigation would have enabled the people to be independent from rainwater, which is especially important given the rainfall is rather scarce, but at the same time, irrigation would also have determined the size and the shape of cultivation areas to which the water was delivered. The largest irrigated areas could have been shared by several groups, and the smaller ones were usually exploited by a single group. But in general, we deal with very small irrigated areas, from less than 1 hectare of surface for the smallest ones, to around 15 for the biggest one, being the average size of 1 hectare. As well as the central option of irrigated areas, complementary strategies such as stock breeding and dry agriculture were developed, but they are less known. The peripheral groups dedicated to the breeding of livestock or the growing of crops are dependent on rain. The networks are therefore not formed by settlements which had the same demography or the same opportunities. As many as 31 settlements were located in the valleys of the southern slope of Mallorca's Tramuntana mountain range, Bunyola, Cua Negra, and Alaró, mainly along the primary and secondary streams. Some of the toponyms in these valleys refer to Berber clans, several of which are known to have founded a number of settlements in the islands. We can see three examples of them. The Banu Ajar, the Banu Furanik, and the Banu Arus are good examples of segmentation and reduplication of the place. The 31 settlements exhibit a close relationship with the points where water was obtained for irrigation through the building of canals. The largest hydraulic systems were constructed along the central waterways in the valleys of this part of the Tramuntana mountain range. For instance, the systems of Bunyola covered around 10 hectares, those of Cua Negra almost 8 hectares, and the one of Alaró 15 hectares. These systems had the most abundant supplies of water, and also the water mills were concentrated in these places. These systems were often shared by several alquerías. We can see the example of Cua Negra, and it was also here that most of the mills were concentrated. Situated in the small tributary valleys of these central waterways, there were other settlements which were also associated with irrigated areas but were much smaller, with irrigated surfaces of less than 2 hectares and one share. Only in exceptional cases they had mills. In other regions of Mallorca, hydraulic systems are not so abundant, such as in the part of Manacor, studied by Sitges, and the Terra de Falanis, studied by Barceló and myself, in the southeast part of the island, where water collection via canal did not exist and irrigation depended mainly on natural springs. This means that a large number of settlements were not linked to irrigated areas, but rather relied on semi-wild and domestic husbandry, taking advantage of scrubland and marshland pastures. Non-irrigated agriculture, which was principally based on cereals, probably developed on the outskirts of these wet areas. In the Terra de Falanis, the Banu Furanik built an irrigated space using the most powerful spring in the region, which measured around 8 hectares. The Banu Farda took water for irrigation from a series of small springs situated on the southern slope of the hill where the chasm of the Felanich was located. Other settlements named after tribal groups are mentioned in the written record as being associated to stock breeding and secondarily to dry farming. As in the case of the Terra de Falanis, in the area of Manacor, studied by Sitges, hydraulic systems were not so abundant and irrigation depended mainly on natural springs. The Mancur, in this case, built the largest irrigated area spread over almost 7 hectares and with two water mills. What is interesting of this case study is the central settlement called Cariat Asoc, which is the Catalan notary transformation of Cariat al Suc, the market alqueria. It was probably a rural market that produced a stable settlement. Notice that all the road point to this place. In the eastern sector of the island, another network of settlement was formed around the Berber group of the Ait Iraten. The name of the Jews of Yartan is linked to this group, which also had other alquerías in the island. The alqueria Almudaina of Artano, Almudaina is an Arabic word for fortification or fortified palace, located in a hill in present-day Arta, must have been inhabited by the Iraten and is associated with one of the largest hydraulic systems in the region, approximately 8 hectares in size and 2 water mills. The territory was settled by both Berber and Arab groups, including the Banu Amira, Banu Ajer, Banu Awrabe, Banu Dahnun, Banu Aylan, Banu Jamila, Banu Abdindar. This region has been studied by Arjemi. The map of Ibiza highlights the association of rural settlements with the cultivated areas, not the irrigated spaces. The wet and drained areas near the Medina of Ibiza, the alluvial lands around the final stretch of Buscastell stream, the area of the plain of Cesalinas, which is also drained, and finally the gorges of Corona and Aubarca in the north, which were probably used as pasture. The map shows that the irrigated systems are concentrated around the basin of the Santa Eulalia River. The short streams which flow towards the northern coast of the island, the streams of Fruitera and Navanera, which flow into the Bay of Ibiza, that of Buscastell, which flows into Portman Bay, and several lesser streams on the southern coast. There are extensive areas with no irrigated spaces. In both the western part and the northern eastern part of the island, the absence of springs or courses that could be used for irrigation corresponds with a lower density of ceramic finds, as well as dearth of preserved or documented Andalusian place names. Special mention should be made of the area near the Medina in the Pla de Vila, where several groups, alongside the inhabitants of the town, built an orchard area surrounding an extensive area of wetland. Amongst them, there were the Berbers, Banu Ajer, we have already seen them in Mallorca, and the Sumatra. This orchard area and its plots of lands are mentioned in the Memoriale Divisiones and other documents written after the conquest. Mention is also made in the Liber Majolicinus, a chronicle of Catalan and Pisan attack and the sacking of the Balearic islands that occurred in 12th century. The humidity of the water flowing from the drainage channels would have been sufficient to guarantee the crops' growth. However, water wheels are mentioned in text and several wells for supplying them have been found. Another good example of a network of settlements is the group of 4 Berber settlements in the valley of Buscastell, the Banu Farda, the Banu Karbun, the Banu Maimun, and the Banu Hawara, built and managed an irrigated space of 2.5 hectares with 4 mills. The channel begins in a spring and runs along the valley. In Menorca, settlement networks were organized around irrigated spaces built at the bottom of 6 ravines in the south of the islands, studied by Barceló and Retamero. These were small irrigation systems, less than 1 hectare in size. The settlements were located at the upper end of the ravines, less than 10 minutes walk from the irrigation systems. There are also a large number of toponyms with Berber roots, Benifamís, Benicalcitz, Benigemor, Benisegarra. Some of the toponyms also refer to Arab groups such as the Yemeni Banu Ruwayl. I only do a short reference to the cities in order not to extend too much my lecture. There was no continuity between Roman and Islamic cities, although the Islamic Medina Mallorca reused the Roman defensive structures. In Polentia, several pits, a few structures, plundered trenches, and assemblage of pottery demonstrate, following Orfila and Riera Runan, the occupation of the Forum area between the 10th and the 11th century. The chronology for the necropolis placed over the Forum of Polentia, obtained by radiocarbon dating, places between the 9th and the 12th centuries a series of burials that didn't follow an Islamic ritual. Following Gao and others, the interpretation of these burials and their chronology constitutes an unresolved issue for the moment. Ibn Khaldun's account of Isam al-Hawlani's conquest includes the earliest allusion to the urban organization of the islands, probably referring to Medina Mallorca. According to this account, Hisham al-Hawlani ordered the construction of mosques, inns, fundus, and baths. Riera Frau thinks that during the period of the Caliphate, the city of Medina Mallorca does not appear to have extended beyond the Roman limits. The city wall was already built in the early 12th century, as demonstrated by the accounts of the Catalan Pisan expedition. The Liber Maiolicinus contains a detailed description of the city, which is sprawled on either side of a torrent and was surrounded by walls. This description also mentions the channel that brought water from a canal built ex professo 8 kilometers north of the city. This channel is referred to as Enel Amir, a term which has been interpreted as a Latinization of Ain al-Amir, the Emir's spring. The course of the wall has been reconstructed by Riera Frau, who claims that the main factor in the design of the wall was not the number of people to be sheltered, but the presence of the channel and its lateral branches. All the streets are traced taking account these water branches. According to documents written after the feudal conquest, at that time the city had around 3,500 houses, 16 mosques, and 5 public baths. Markets, including those specializing in coal, silver, tools, and pottery, were located near the gates. These urban developments did not crystallize, however, until the 11th century. Yavissa was considered a small city by the Andalusian chroniclers. Al-Idrisi states that in Yavissa there is a good city which, despite its small size, has all the amenities required by civilization. Al-Himyari describes it as a good small city which has all the things that one finds in a big populous cities. The Catalans referred to this urban center as castrum, and thus they appear not to have considered it a proper city. Again, the Liber Maiolicinus conveys a detailed description of the city, especially the walls, which comprised three circuits. That around the cars that around the city, and one that encircled a suburban area or arbor. This account also mentions the Moat, which is described as a channel flooded with wet water from the marshlands. The excavations undertaken in Ibiza's old town have discovered several of the sections of the walls and towers and a part of this suburb mentioned in the written sources. Very little is known about Medina Menorca. There have been some excavations, but these have only been partially published. The reconstruction of the Islamic city proposed by Retamero and Moll chiefly depends on the documents generated after the Christian conquest in the late 13th century. According to these authors, the Medina was in the late 13th century no bigger than 5 hectares in size. Inside the city, written documents mention houses, 5 furnaces, 2 corn markets, bread ovens near the mosque, and gardens and fodder fields, which occupied the unbuilt spaces. There was also a castle, the residence of the Reyes of Menorca, at the moment of the conquest. In the Balearics, then, urban centers were chiefly promoted by the Caliphate and especially the Taifa Kingdom. The numismatic records suggest that the fiscal structure of the island became consolidated in the Taifa period also, and it is therefore not surprising that the urban development of the three main cities did not take off until the 11th century. As I'm already concluding, as pointed out above, the initial process of colonization must have happened over a short time span and involved sufficient numbers to guarantee the success. Barceló suggests the first half of the 10th century for this process of establishing the key features of rural settlement and the agricultural systems upon which they depended. The observed homogeneity shows that any later modifications of this type of settlement had never significantly changed the initial system, and they are difficult to recognize because they still use the same technical knowledge and the same selection criteria. To date, however, it has been difficult to identify this process archaeologically. We have detected the network of settlement cum agricultural area that received the Catalan invaders in the 13th century when they reached the peak of their development. We have identified traces of the processes that followed the initial settlement, for instance, the conversion of rahals, originally subsidy working areas, into alquerías, or the building of new irrigated areas next to the original ones as a way of expanding the initial agrarian space. However, our knowledge does not extend to all phases of colonization. We still lack of geoarchaeological studies and precise dating of these agricultural areas. Besides, there are very few excavated rural settlements in the Balearic Islands. Only recently have the Islamic stratigraphic context been paid attention. But most of these are rescue excavations or are related to projects whose goal is not investigate the Andalusi settlement, but rather a reused prehistoric site. There is no ongoing long-term excavation project that aims to analyze rural settlement patterns. Thus, the settlement distribution has been analyzed mainly through archaeological survey, hydraulic archaeology, and the analysis of the place names. By and large, archaeological surveys have not yielded material that predates the 11th century, and very few excavated assemblages have been dated to the 10th century. From Mallorca, we should note the collections of small jars found in reused prehistoric or late Roman settlements. In Menorca, no archaeological context dating to the 10th century has been found to date. In Ibiza, in contrast, the analysis of the material held by the Museum of Ibiza and Formentera and the small pottery assemblages coming from the castle excavation has led to the identification of a local ceramic tradition that could be underway as early as the 10th century. If there is something peculiar about these peasant groups that settled in the Balearic Islands, is the technical means by which they undertook their colonization endeavor, from the overseas transport of people, animals, plants, seeds, and tools, to the selection and construction of agricultural spaces. They created a peasant-based network of settlements that was to determine the settlement pattern up to the modern age. In any case, in its initial configuration during the Caliphate, the state played no substantial role in the formation of agricultural spaces on which the livelihood of the peasant groups depended. Research carried out over the last 30 years in the Balearic Islands has not only allowed for an accurate description of the migration process and the technical means with which the following colonization was effected, but also has shown the scale of the process. The average surface area irrigated by hydraulic systems in the Balearic, is relatively small, around 1 hectare in average. As pointed out by Retamero, the small size of agricultural units was not only related to the technical limitations of the hydraulic systems, but also to a deliberate policy. Despite their small size, these agricultural systems had a substantial ecological impact. The migration of peasant groups in the 10th century resulted in the emergence of a new agrarian landscape with no direct local precedents that may have conditioned the colonization pattern. The excavation of agrarian structures that were used before the arrival of Muslim colonists for the processing of agricultural and animal products has not provided evidence for the previous land use structure. In any case, pre-Islamic settlements, which provide little evidence for continuity after the 7th or the 8th centuries, were not usually reoccupied after the 10th century. The explanation for this lies in the following facts. The settlement of the Berber and Arab immigrants was heavily conditioned by the selection of appropriate spaces for cultivation and the agricultural model imported by the new arrivals was entirely novel, both in technical irrigation systems and landscape terms, occupation of the valley bottoms and some terraced slopes. The reoccupation of some Roman settlements, especially Palma, and the abandonment of others, like Polentia or Sanicera in Menorca, also resulted in the emergence of a new urban model. Even if the survival of Christian groups, at least in Polentia, with roots that stretch back to late antiquity, after the 8th century and 9th century, and even in the 10th century, is finally ascertained, it do not undermine the enormous impact that Berber and Arab migration had from the 10th century onwards. And finally, the new agrarian landscape that emerged from the Berber and Arabic migration was to have a crucial impact on the colonization instigated from the 13th century onwards by the feudal conquerors. The Catalan colonies, led by the feudal lords, encountered rigid irrigation spaces which they tried to adapt to a new production regime based on the collection of feudal rents. Thank you for your attention.